Welcome to Getting Started with Open Pedagogy. My name is Heather Maselli. I'm a lecturer at Roger Williams University in Bristol, Rhode Island, and I'm joined with my colleagues, and they're going to introduce themselves now.
Hi, everybody. I'm Will Cross. My title's kind of a mouthful. I'm the director of the Open Knowledge Center and head of information policy at NC State, which just means I'm the lawyer in the libraries, and I get to do all the fun open stuff.
Hi, everyone. My name is Lindsay Gavush, formerly Lindsay Gum. I use she, her pronouns, and I am the scholarly communications librarian at Roger Williams University in Rhode Island. I'm also the fellow for open education at the New England Board of Higher Ed. Okay, so before we can really dive into open ped, we need to understand how we got here. So we wouldn't be here talking about open pedagogy without the scholarship of several educational theorists that work to break down barriers of white supremacist educational systems. An emancipatory approach to education that is heavily represented in the works of Paulo Freire, bell hooks, Ira Shore, Henry Giroux, and Peter McLaren is an innovative approach in education which has been successful in practice. Emancipatory pedagogies focus on the notion that education should play a role in creating a just and democratic society. This requires a negotiated curriculum based on true dialogue that values social interaction, collaboration, authentic democracy, and self-actualization towards making fundamental changes both individually and socially. Black scholar bell hooks challenge us to confront and transgress traditional boundaries of power and authority so that our classrooms can truly become democratic spaces that support all students in the daily work towards freedom. Hooks also challenges us as educators to explore and subscribe to a self-care routine that centers well-being, healing, and belonging so that we can teach in a way that empowers our students. This made me think back to the time I heard Dr. Beverly Daniel Tatum, who is the author of Why Are All the Black Kids Sitting Together in the Cafeteria, speak, and she said, if you're making a lot of withdrawals, you better be sure that you're making just as many deposits. Next slide, please. So this brings us to constructionist pedagogy. Constructionist pedagogy is a set of principles based on the idea that knowledge is constructed during experience, such as real-world problem solving, and by reflecting on those experiences. In the classroom, educators act less so as the sage on the stage and pivot, where learners are provided with the opportunity to construct meaning and learn by making connections between their existing knowledge and the new ideas, concepts, and facts. It's moving away from the concept that the teacher supplies the knowledge and moving towards students constructing the knowledge. Scholars who contributed to this educational theory include Piaget, Vygotsky, Dewey, Vico, Rorty, and Brunner. Next slide, please. Okay, so what is open pedagogy? Depending on who you ask, this answer will vary, but we like this encapsulation from Dr. Rajiv Jangiani. An access-oriented commitment to learner-driven education and as a process of designing architectures and using tools for learning that enable students to shape the public knowledge commons of which they are a part. So simply put, open pedagogy is a process by which educators invite our students to be co-creators of knowledge that lives and is shared beyond the confines of the classroom walls. Next slide, please. What that actually looks like will differ from classroom to classroom, educator to educator, and from ultimately from student to student. Some attributes of open pedagogy include the use of participatory technologies, values of openness and trust, creativity, sharing ideas and resources, connected community, content that is learner-generated, and actions like reflective practice and peer review. Next slide, please. Scholars Wiley and Hilton sought to further narrow and define the concept of open pedagogy, ultimately settling on the term OER-enabled pedagogy, which they define as the set of teaching and learning practices that are only possible or practical in the context of the five R permissions that are characteristic of OER. Building exclusively on the five R's of open, so again, they are reuse, revise, remix, redistribute, and retain, educators can ask the following four questions to better distinguish OER-enabled pedagogy from, say, for example, project-based learning. So the first question they ask is, are students asked to create new artifacts? So that might be an essay, a poem, a video, or a song. Or are they asked to revise or remix existing OER? Does the new artifact have value beyond supporting the learning of its author? Are students invited to publicly share their new artifacts or revised, remixed OER? And finally, are students invited to openly license their new artifacts or revised, remixed OER? So you can see how this is a really narrow definition as opposed to something that's a little more broad. So if you can go to the next slide, please. And finally, open pedagogy allows us to actionalize Lambert's social justice framework for open education, specifically recognitive and representational justice. So OER as content helps us apply the redistributive justice, which ensures that all students have free and perpetual access to their learning materials. Unfortunately, we know that not all learning materials, whether they're OER or commercial, are of the same quality, particularly when it comes to presenting sociocultural diversity in materials, perspectives, and experiences. So open pedagogy allows opportunities for faculty and students to be co-creators of culturally affirmative learning materials by revising and remixing existing OER, or by encouraging learners who have been historically underserved and underrepresented by higher education to contribute their own experiences, perspectives, and stories to their learning materials. Next slide, please. So now Heather is going to hopefully tie everything that I just, you know, shared with you together in examples so it can kind of start to come to life for you.
Thank you, Lindsay. I'm going to be talking about examples, including some very specific examples. But first, if Will could advance the slide, we're going to start out with a bunch of excellent resources that you can use to check out. There's so many open pedagogy projects from so many different disciplines, and these resources do a really good job of taking into account all of the diversity in projects that exist. So the Open Pedagogy Notebook is it's a blog type website where faculty and open practitioners can submit their projects, their blogs to share what they've done in their courses. The Open Pedagogy Roadmap is a wonderful resource if you're starting from scratch. It has a lot of step-by-step, like what things you need to consider when you are creating an open pedagogy project. The Guide to Making Open Textbooks with Students is obviously a wonderful guide if you're considering challenging your students with writing a textbook for your course. Open Pedagogy Approaches looks at the collaborations between faculty and librarians and student collaborations within open pedagogy. And then the last slide is really highlighting that there are a ton of amazing libguides out there on open pedagogy. This one in particular is from Iowa State, but many libraries have truly amazing open libguides that you can check out to look for examples of open pedagogy. Next slide. So the first specific project that I'm going to talk about is my own. I am a general education science instructor at Roger Williams University. Core 101 is our gen ed course that all students take, unless they're in the sciences, so all non-majors take this course. And it has two objectives. They have to talk about science and they have to learn the scientific method. And so I used to teach this class very traditionally, exams, papers. It wasn't very exciting. And then I was introduced to the concept of open pedagogy. And I decided that instead of having my students write papers solely for me, what if they created a textbook that was written by non-majors for non-majors? And what ultimately came out of it is the series of websites. If you can advance the slide, Will. There are currently 12 websites published. All focused on societally relevant topics in science, such as climate change and vaccines. During each semester, students review the website as it currently exists, identifying areas where the content needs to be added or updated and areas that need major revision. Each website is in a different level of development. For example, our space exploration page, which has had 42 student authors over 8 semesters, has been put into semi-retired status. The website is still used as a resource in the course, but the website itself was getting a little unwieldy. The topics that we could expand to were probably well beyond the understanding of a general education course. And so we decided to halt it. Last spring, a group of my honor students decided to smooth out a lot of the major edits that were needed, and we gave that website a break from editing. Another example of the difference in editing status is also last spring, the ecology and biodiversity page was created for the first time. And so it doesn't have as much content on it as like our space page, because we've only had one set of student authors and there's only 3 of them. Next slide, please, Will. The beauty of these Open Pedagogy websites is that each semester there are events that happen that are relevant to our website topics. For example, here, the semester this page was updated, we had read an article about the first ever CRISPR gene surgery that could help cure genetic blindness. The students thought it was interesting and relevant, so we added it. Next slide, please. Other examples include climate-related events, such as Texas winter storm last February, which prompted an addition about how the polar vortex is impacted by climate change, as well as various wildfire events. Next slide. Another very important example is how the vaccine page was updated several times in the past 3 years to discuss the COVID-19 vaccines and the new mRNA technology used to develop those vaccines. Next slide, please. Another real benefit to these projects is the ability for students to focus on the intersections of science and their disciplines. A few semesters ago, I had a student that was a Latin American studies minor and had learned about climate change related migration in one of her other courses. And she wanted to explore a little bit more of the science side of the issue in our class, but she added some of the sociological implications on our website. Another group of students decided to focus on some privacy issues using AI technology and education. Next slide, Will. This was after pivoting to online remote courses because of COVID. Next slide. Another great example is this page from the vaccine website, where my students focused on the disparities in vaccination rates in different groups, both because of health coverage, but also because of distrust in the medical establishment. On this page, they outline the Tuskegee syphilis study and how the exploitation of African Americans by the medical establishment had shaped their views of new or experimental treatments, such as the COVID-19 vaccines. Next slide. These projects completely changed the way that I approached my course. And I began to collect some data. This data is from fall of 2021. You can see the sample size is 26. That's about 2/3 of the students that I had in fall of 2021. And this metric is using a confidence scale. And the students take a pre and a post test. And as you can see, the way that the course is taught using this Open Pedagogy project is kind of a backbone where students get to investigate topics that they are interested in and topics that they can find connections to their real life or their majors and their interests. You can see that coming into a general education science course, the students have a much lower confidence in themselves, in their scientific skills. And these scientific skills include reading papers, reading graphs, understanding where information comes from. And they come into the class feeling fairly confident, but by the end of the course, they are feeling much more confident in those skills because of this course. Next slide. So the next example that I'm going to talk about are course materials. These specifically are virtual organic chemistry labs developed by Dr. Maria Gallardo Williams at North Carolina State University. This website shows the North Carolina State undergraduate organic chemistry teaching laboratory smart lab videos. And if you go to the next slide, Dr. Gallardo Williams had her teaching assistants help her create videos to help illustrate complex organic chemistry concepts and lab techniques during the COVID-19 pandemic. You can see this picture. This TA actually has a camera over their head so that the students actually get this first-person view of what is going on in the lab. So it's kind of a virtual reality experience. So using TAs to create course materials that are openly licensed and that can be used by anyone, anywhere, especially for virtual or emergency remote situations, has been really helpful. They've also done some cross-disciplinary collaborations, particularly with the dance program at North Carolina State. Here they are dancing chemical reactions. And sharing this out is just another way to show how complex chemical reactions can be explained using different media. It doesn't have to be writing pen on a paper to answer a question. It can be walking around in a room and dancing it to make it easier to understand or access. Next slide. And so here is the webpage that shows some of these organic chemistry lab experiences. The first virtual lab is thin layer chromatography. They went through and filmed these videos so that students could get a lab experience without actually having to be in a lab setting. Next slide. For a lot of people, projects like mine and Dr. Gallardo Williams, they seem overwhelming. They take up a lot of time in the classroom. Sometimes they require you to shift the way you approach teaching a class. They take effort. And sometimes we don't have that bandwidth. We are still working through a pandemic, and people don't always have a lot of time on their hands to make wide sweeping course changes, which is why I wanted to share this example. This is a single assignment. It's assigned by Dr. Virginia Clinton LaSalle from the University of North Dakota. And this assignment is just making scientific memes. She assigns her students to choose one of the resources that they've talked about in the semester, these scientific studies that she teaches in one of her psychology courses. And she asks them to communicate the research findings from those studies into memes. And those memes are shared on social media to disseminate accurate information and allow others to use them. It's a one-off assignment. It doesn't take very much time to incorporate into a course. It allows students to distill information from a very dense source and put it into something that they are probably far more familiar with, a meme format, and then share it out publicly. And now I think Will is going to be talking about how you can go ahead and get started with Open Pedagogy.
Thank you so much, Heather. So that's what Open Pedagogy is, sort of the foundational things, and then some examples as well. I'm excited to take a little time to talk about how to get started on Open Pedagogy in your own classroom or in your own community. And the first thing to say is that Open Pedagogy doesn't have to take a single form, doesn't rely on a specific tool. There's not just one sort of right way to do it. Indeed, baked into Open Pedagogy at a pretty fundamental level is an explicit recognition that there is no one-size-fits-all approach to this stuff. Open science practitioners often like to say that their work should be, quote, as open as possible, as closed as necessary. And that's absolutely the case with Open Pedagogy as well. Any approach to Open Pedagogy should be intentional about these core values that we're talking about. And then the way that you put those values into practice is going to depend on the context for your work and the needs of your community and that sort of thing as well. Another way to think about this idea comes from our colleague Mahabali. She has a wonderful article, and you can see the link at the bottom here, that talks about Open Pedagogy as process-centric, meaning that it's not about a specific output or a specific product. Instead, Open Pedagogy should be about understanding something as moving your education from centering content, centering pedagogy, and centering the voice of the instructor, and moving that towards process, justice, and the voice of the learner as well. And crucially, all of these are understood as existing on a spectrum. It's not that you are doing bad things and you need to switch over to the binary of doing it, quote, the right way. It's thinking about where am I on the spectrum now and what can I do to move my pedagogies forward in different ways. Another way to say what I just said and what Maha said so well is to recognize, as Clint Lalonde does here in this quote, that Open Pedagogy is fundamentally about connection and community and building processes that make our pedagogy more transparent, more understandable, and available. In other words, pedagogies that are more open. So the first step for Open Pedagogy then is simply engaging with those values and those ideas within yourself and centering them in the way you interact with educators and students. There are examples of genuine, complete, wonderful open pedagogy that are nothing more or less than an orientation towards agency, inclusion, and openness. And you can see some of the ideas for support that we have here as well in the work that you're doing, in the scaffolding that you might provide to students, and the way we work with our colleagues in the field as well. So that's the first step, is the open values. A next step for many educators can be applying those values into a set of open interventions. Those can be specific, concrete changes, large and small, that you make in your teaching. One really simple but powerful intervention that you could make is sharing your syllabus openly. That way, students can come into your class with more information about what will be covered and what they're going to expect. And then other instructors can also learn from your syllabus so that the field as a whole can grow and improve. So simply taking your syllabus and making it available, that's open pedagogy that can be really powerful and really significant in a concrete way. In addition to that, another simple intervention can be simply updating your syllabus language to explicitly address the values that we've been discussing. Everything from a more humane attendance and late work policy to a clear discussion about student agency and privacy can make your classroom more open, even if you're still using a closed commercial textbook and the disposable assignments that we've been talking about. So openness as grounded in those interventions and the way we engage with each other. And of course, support for those interventions can take many different forms, from sharing resources with one another or exemplifying different models, to working with librarians, departmental colleagues, and collaboration on other things as well. So values as step one, interventions as another way to do that. The third sort of option or approach to open pedagogy we want to talk about is open assignments. And of course, for many people, when they think about open pedagogy, the first thing they think about are these open assignments. Lindsay talked some about the value of open, renewable assignments, and Heather did a nice job of talking about what those look like in practice. And I think Heather in particular mentioned Dr. Robin DeRosa's Open Anthology of Early American Literature. This is a classic example of this process, inviting students to research and share the stories of underrepresented voices in the field. So they're making selections on their own, exercising their agency, they're centering underrepresented voices in a way that can be reparative and restorative, and then they're sharing something out to the commons, all three of those ideas that we've been talking about. And I love this example as well because Robin, Dr. DeRosa, creates the original version, and then the openness lets it be sort of iterated on and used by other people in different ways as well. So on the right here, we have Matthew Moore, who's the current head editor of the second edition of the Open Anthology of Earlier American Literature. So the idea that someone plants a seed and other people can sort of harvest from the great things that grow and then plant those seeds in their own fields and go from there. And this is a great example of that process happening in a really incredible way. New editors, new editions, continually expanding set of materials. What an exciting way to think about open assignments. As Heather discussed, open assignments can often come in many different flavors, and they work in just about any field or discipline you can think of. So we're highlighting here Rajiv Janyani's approach to having students create new test questions along with a set of credible distractors. This is often a great fit for those larger courses where it feels like there are way too many students for me to do the sort of high touch things that Heather was talking about a minute ago. And in addition, with it being sort of a lighter touch way to bring openness and creation into the space, it's also a nice way to add the benefit of building out an expanding test bank, which adds value to an existing assigned text. So we're making the pedagogy better in really explicit ways for the students in the classroom today and for the field as a whole going forward. Open assignments, of course, can benefit from many different kinds of support, from sharing ideas and impressions with peers, to clear scaffolding that prepares students and instructors for what may be an unfamiliar way of working together and of also assessing that work. And of course, there are libraries and centers for faculty excellence and support and that sort of thing that offer explicit support for this open pedagogy. And that can come in the form of shared expertise, that can come in the form of financial support and that sort of thing. But that partnership between a faculty instructor and a librarian or another expert on campus, that peanut butter and chocolate can be really, really powerful, particularly in this context. And then finally, the last way, another way, let's say, to think about open pedagogy is to think about flipping an entire course to open. This can be a big lift in some cases, but it can also be really, really exciting and powerful. Saying from the syllabus that we're using to the assignments that we're engaging in together to the assessment that we're going to use to talk about how we've done, open pedagogy can be a radical, exciting change in this space. And here again, we have sort of a common and well-scaffolded example is adopting the WikiEDU platform in order to focus students' coursework on updating materials in a resource they probably know pretty well, Wikipedia. I'd suggest if you're interested that you take a look at the Wiki Education dashboard linked at the bottom here to see if this approach looks like a good fit for your course. In addition to a more formal sort of tool-based approach like WikiEDU, instructors can also invite students to explore and co-create the course syllabus directly. This can be a powerful way to give students real agency to really say, this is what we're doing, this is what we're studying, this is what's meaningful to me. It can also give students an important insight into what's covered and why the course is structured in the way that it is. And it also is a great opportunity for students to have an open conversation about how we're going to interact with each other. When is it rude to get up in the middle of class? When is it totally humane for a student to be able to get up in the middle of class if they need to take a bio break or that sort of thing? So that the co-creation of what we're doing and how we're doing it can be an opportunity to interrogate and also an opportunity to tailor in some really exciting and important ways. And here again, we have some ideas for supporting this stuff, a lot of the same sense of building community, of sharing ideas, and of highlighting the different types of expertise that different people have on campus and in the world in different ways. So those are four approaches to thinking about open pedagogy. As I say, it's not a good one versus a bad one. Maybe it's a spectrum from lighter touch to higher touch, but mostly it is four really great ways to open up your pedagogy, to center those values of justice and inclusion that Lindsay talked about, and to really give students a sense of agency and production of things in the world that's so, so meaningful for students in 1,000 different contexts. Quickly, before we jump into our last section, I wanted to share again this thing that Heather shared a moment ago. These are the links to all the resources that she mentioned. So if you went, what was that open pedagogy notebook thing? There's the link for that. You know, what's the roadmap look like? There's the link for that. These slides, of course, are openly licensed and available, so you can go back and find this anytime. But those are some of the resources that we talked about. Because we only have a limited time today, we're really just getting the tip of the tip of the iceberg. There are so many incredible things happening in open pedagogy right now. And so on that note, I'm going to stop dominating the conversation and open it up I'm happy to introduce this section and ask the first question, and then maybe we can pass the baton around if that's okay. I see a couple of nods, so nobody's throwing anything at me. I feel good about that. Heather did the good work of reaching out to a lot of our peers on social media and saying, hi, what are the questions that you wrestle with most often? What are the things that you need to have a good answer to or wish you had a good answer to, or just, you know, what are the frequently asked or common questions? And so we're going to share some of those questions that we heard back from folks in the community and then take a minute to talk about how we might address or answer those questions, or at least start having a conversation about those questions. So the first question, is it still open pedagogy if a student chooses not to openly license their artifact? Lindsay and Heather, what do you think?
Heather, you want to take this?
Yeah, I mean, I would say yes. I think open pedagogy is, it's a practice that I do. And part of that practice is giving students agency to make decisions about their content, their intellectual property, and whether or not they want to share it, have it openly licensed, and put it out in the world. Lindsay, do you want to add to that?
Yeah. I mean, I would 100% agree with what you just said. And I think from what we've heard today with all of us kind of contributing, it's hard to put this term in a box, and I don't like to put it in a box. Because I think that can alienate certain students, and that's not what we want to do here. And I think from my perspective, I think giving, as long as we give the student and inform them, you know, you have the opportunity to openly license your intellectual property, as long as you, you know, present them with that option. I think that for me, that's what makes it open pedagogy. It's not, you know, the black and white yes or no, you have to share this or you don't. I think it's just, hey, isn't this cool that you could share your knowledge beyond our classroom walls and other people could learn from you? For me, that's what gets me and students excited, I think. So yeah. Will, if you want me to take over from here, and I'll jump in when I can. So the next question that we crowdsourced was, how is it different from project-based learning or community-engaged learning? And I do hear this a lot from faculty. Will, Heather?
I can take this one again for the lead. I think it's different because of that sharing piece. I don't think that it's a separate practice that cannot be done with project-based learning or community-engaged learning. In fact, some of the best examples of open pedagogy that I've seen out there are where it's a project-based learning activity that they've shared their results with, you know, into the open, or a community-engaged project where, again, artifacts that are created from this community effort are then shared outside of the classroom. And I think the two go so closely hand in hand that it's not different from them. It's just the open pedagogy is an extra layer that you can kind of put on top of these projects to just make it, like you said, more exciting. You know, doing community engaged learning or doing project-based learning, the students are already very excited about what they're learning. And to be able to share outwards, I think, adds a layer of authenticity that sometimes gets lost if you keep everything in the realm of the classroom. And once you can share, you're starting to, you know, students start to care about it a little bit differently than when it's contained within a classroom.
Great. Yeah, I'll plus one everything Heather just said and add to that. One of my favorite things about open pedagogy is it sort of takes so freely from other pedagogies and said, there's been an amazing world of things that's already done. Let's take the best part and sort of recontextualize it in some ways. Some of the biggest light bulb moments that I've had when speaking with faculty is when they go, oh, you're talking about constructivist stuff, or I see some community engaged stuff here. Now I have a handhold in this stuff. Now I really, I'm excited about that as an instructor as well. So that it can or cannot be different. To the extent that it is not different, that's one of the big strengths, I think.
Absolutely. Plus one to both of you. Okay, this is another big one that we hear. How does FERPA, so FERPA, if you're not aware of that, is the Family Educational Rights and Privacy Act. How does FERPA come into play with open pedagogy?
Yeah, this is, I'll start on this one, and other folks, please feel free to jump in as well. So speaking with my lawyer's hat on, FERPA is the law and you should do it, right? I mean, they're, let's be completely unambiguous about that. But what FERPA establishes is basically a floor. If you do less than this true bare minimum, there could be legal trouble for you. I think one of the things Open Pedagogy really prides itself on is doing much more than the minimum in terms of centering those values of privacy and student agency in different ways. We mentioned Rajiv Janyani a moment ago, and a quote of his that I always come back to is the idea that open pedagogy without student agency is exploitation. Mm-hmm. That if you said, okay, every student, you have to use your real name, you have to post on this particular social media platform, like that can put students in genuine physical danger and also in really uncomfortable situations. Mm-hmm. So FERPA as a North Star in terms of saying, hey, students have rights and agency that need to be respected is absolutely central to open pedagogy. And then FERPA as a set of legal requirements that we all know we need to be intentional about is sort of the floor that we walk on with our eyes hopefully pointed higher than just that floor.
Absolutely agree. I have nothing to add.
That's why we have Will here.
Yep,
a lawyer.
I talked enough for three people. Love the sound of my own voice.
All right, let's go to our last question. Do students just, quote, do whatever they want? Where is the rigor? How do I give up control? How do I assess open projects? These are all really, really good questions that I think are valid and that faculty ask often. And I'm going to hand it over to Heather, our faculty member. I think you can probably speak to this one.
Yes, I can, because that is a common question that I get is, where's the rigor? And I think one of the beautiful things about open pedagogy, and like I mentioned in the last, in the question about project-based and community-engaged learning, is that once you open a project or an assignment, it lends itself to this authenticity. It becomes something more than a paper that I'm going to grade. It's on the internet. Their projects are on the internet. They can't plagiarize because the penalty is that people will know that they're plagiarizing. In my opinion, I think there's more rigor in open pedagogy projects because you're putting them out there for far more than just a faculty member to see, or the students are putting their work out there far more than a faculty member grading an assignment. And I think, you know, it does require, if you choose a large project, it does require you to give up a little bit of control. And that's why some people who choose open pedagogy projects choose smaller projects to begin with. I'm not one of those people. I jump all in and change everything. But that's just how I've always been as an instructor. But one way that you can give up control is to start small. Start with the single meme example or something similar in your course and see how it goes. It's so easy to get overwhelmed with any kind of pedagogical change, let alone bringing in kind of this other world of knowledge, like copyright and intellectual property and student agency, that you can get lost in the weeds and actually end up, if you give up too much control, you can actually, like Will said, you could actually set yourself up to harm your students if you're not really thinking clearly about everything. So definitely, like, step by step, like start small, work your way up if that's more comfortable for you. I don't want to continue talking.
Well, I just wanted to jump in here. This question very much focuses on like faculty discomfort, but I also want to like just bring up, there's a lot of student discomfort in open pedagogy. This is often a very new experience for them. Heather, have you ever had students kind of push back in your class to say like, this is too new, I don't understand why we're doing this? Students who might be just, you know, walking into your class expecting to listen to you, to take notes, to walk in the next day, take a quiz or take an exam and kind of fly under the radar?
Kind of. But not too much. I've been really lucky in that, I think, because I think you're right. I think there is a level of student discomfort because when students think about what a college class is supposed to look like, that's nothing like what my class looks like. And so one thing that I have to do really well is to explain the purpose of everything, the reason why I'm making these pedagogical choices. And I think that's something you should be doing anyway, whether or not you're doing open pedagogy or any other kind of different pedagogy from traditional lecturing, exams, that kind of thing. I think being transparent with students, it eases their comfort so that they understand the choices that you're making. And I had another thought and it has gone. I don't know where it went.
Okay. Well, why don't I take the opportunity to jump in and underline what you all said really well, which is to me, one of the things that stands out in this question is this idea about rigor and is something rigorous enough? And is that how we evaluate our courses? And to me, one of the things I love about open pedagogy is it really centers authentic rigor, which is like, does this actually work in the communities where students actually live? The difference between I'm going to be a hard ass in my class just because these students are too soft and I'm going to toughen them up or whatever, versus like the students are sharing this in a community of practice and they're getting direct, authentic feedback from that community. You built this thing with this set of assumptions and that doesn't work as well as you think. So I think about we worked a few years ago with a faculty member who used WikiEDU, and they got some super rigorous comments from the WikiEDU editors, because Wikipedia's editors, you know, are really serious about that. That was a different kind of rigor than a professor who said, oh, you misspelled a word there, -5 points or whatever. But it was, I think students went like, okay, this is thoughtful, relevant, authentic feedback that's really pushing me to do good work in a real concrete context. And I think they, in a sense, appreciated and liked that a lot more, because it felt like this isn't just a teacher trying to put me through my paces because that's what they think is good for me to eat my vegetables. This is really what's meaningful and is going to be meaningful in the work I want to do in my life.
Yeah, and that kind of slides into that last question on this slide, is how do you assess open projects? And that's a big question. And it's something that I've really had to sit and ponder with, because the simple answer is you create a rubric. Maybe you collaborate on creating your rubric with your students. But to me, that still doesn't feel authentic, right? I want my students to get good concrete feedback that's both positive and negative. And I want them to get feedback from their peers. So I incorporate a lot of peer review into these projects because my students are the audience for these projects. This is a project, it's meant to be kind of like a textbook for them. They use it every week. They don't need my feedback as much as they might need like audience feedback, right? But one thing that I've had to sit with is that the values that we have as open practitioners kind of butt up against these traditional grading practices. And so there's actually a small but sure movement of open practitioners starting to look at alternative assessments. They're not giving points and using dedicated rubrics. They're allowing students to self-reflect on their projects using maybe specs grading or mastery-based learning or even full ungrading, collaborative grading. And I think open pedagogy opens the door to those kinds of questions about what does assessment actually mean and how can I start to incorporate like these alternate models of open assessment, especially on open projects, because they're getting so much more than a grade when they do a project using open pedagogy.
Those were both fantastic answers. Thank you. Well, that wraps up our questions. Any final thoughts from either of you or me? No?
I'll just say quickly that this is really what you make of it, and I think that's the most exciting piece of it. So if you were listening to this and going, okay, I don't like 75% of that, but I'm 25% interested. Good. Tack towards that 25%, and there's something really good for you there, particularly if you can find good partners. I think we're here on behalf of the Open Education Network, and the reason that we've worked with them to make this conversation that they've been having about open pedagogy, about community and collaboration, as opposed to saying, like, this one person is going to wander in the wilderness and become the leader in open ped, is it just works better that way. Mm-hmm. So find your people, build a good community, and do the stuff that's exciting for you, and you'll be doing great stuff.
I was going to echo exactly that one of the best definitions of open pedagogy that I've seen not only encompasses what happens in a classroom, but it encompasses what we do with our teaching practices. Mm-hmm. And go out, find your people, share, tell us what you're doing, because every open pedagogy project that I've encountered, I've gotten some little nugget of information that might make my open pedagogy projects a little bit better.
Yeah, and I'll finally just close with, you know, along the lines of finding your people, there are certainly folks at your institution, if you're a faculty member, who want to help you with this. I will call out my own people, librarians. We are more than excited and enthusiastic to partner with you, to help you think through projects, and to support you. So thank you all for listening. And I think with that, we will sign off.